Hello everyone, my name is Gareth Dennis. I'm a rail engineer from the UK, and this is a new series which is going to be called An Engineer Watches. Well there's this genre of YouTube video that we have at the moment, which is experts commenting on stuff that they know about in film and on TV, and who am I to stem the tide? In fact, I'm an absolute sucker for that genre. I love those. I think I've watched hours of them. They're great. But I've not spotted a single railway one yet. So I figured I'd do one myself. Do it a bit differently. Watch a scene from a particular film and break it down in detail and look at kind of what is correct and what is not correct. The hits and the misses, if you like. And what better scene from a film to start with than going for Mission Impossible. It's probably one of the most famous train sequences out there. It's brilliant fun. Indeed, it's 1996's Mission Impossible. And we're going to kick off with the famous railway sequence at the in the kind of the third act of the film. So without further ado, there we are. It's setting the scene. Just had a spoiler alert. And here we go. Okay. Let's. Here he is. He's angry. He's about to get up. Let's kick off. Right. So let's stop here. So first things first. what's this? What's this thing? I'm gonna do working down here for anyone who's. We're gonna put our working down here. What's this thing? It's a ladder onto the roof of a train from inside the train. Do those exist anywhere? I don't think they do. I'm afraid that's gonna have to go down as a miss. It's gonna have to go down as a miss. And another thing though is actually, what's all this space here? What's this? This is a as we find out, we'll find out later what the train is, but it's a this bit of the train that he is about to emerge out of is actually on the TGV train that we're about to see momentarily. It's all just electrical equipment. There's no nice empty space, and with modern passenger trains, you don't generally have just a bit of empty space. You try and pack it out with seats. So yeah, I'm not quite sure what this empty space is. But anyway, okay, so that's another miss, I'm afraid. Off to a great start, but let's keep watching. Right, okay. He has just jumped out of the weird hatch, out onto the top of the train, and is holding on to something I would never recommend holding on to, which is this thing here. You see this sort of thing here? This is a pantograph. It's like a horn that collects electricity at the top of the train. And people often go, it's not right. The pantograph is down. This is an electric train. It's got to collect its electricity from overheads. Okay. We're not going to do double jeopardy. Later on, we find out that this train actually does just rely on overheads. Fine. But if this is the train going through kind of southern England on its way to the Channel Tunnel, then in 1996, the train very much did not use overheads. It relied on what we call the direct current contact rail, the third rail, down at track level. So the pantograph would in fact be down. Frankly, I wouldn't want to be touching it for fear of any sort of stray current floating around, but it's fine. There's no OLE at this point. There's no overhead lines. So yes, the pantograph would indeed be down. This does refer back to the fact that he just came out of the ladder. If you just think of the geography of where he crossed the ladder, came up out of the hatch, directly underneath this is that empty area, which is like, well, what? Wouldn't expect there to be a totally empty. Anyway, it's fine. So, but that's just fine. The fact that there is the pantograph is down is fine. That's a hit. That's allowed. Let's keep watching. Oh, it's fun. There's a bridge. Crikey. Oh yeah, yes, of course. Of course, this whole sequence is really a chase scene between a helicopter and a train. This is the McDonnell Douglas. No, it's not the McDonnell Douglas. It used to be McDonnell Douglas. It's now MD helicopters. They were bought by Boeing. I'm not an aeronautical engineer, but this helicopter was specifically chosen by the production team because it doesn't have a tail rotor. The tail rotor is there to counteract the torque from the big kind of primary blade spinning around. You have the tail rotor which accelerates, decelerates to kind of counteract torque and also yaw the plane. Or the helicopter. In this instance, there's like the exhaust is used to counteract the torque, and then little jets help yaw the little sort of outlets kind of yaw the helicopter in the direction the pilot wants to take it. So it was chosen so that it could do the thing that it's going to do later without the tail rotor getting in the way. It's also easier for animation. Now, if we pull up the specs of this, here it is. The MD-520N is the particular helicopter there. It's very, very snazzy with an incredibly naff-looking details brochure. Anyway, from this you can go in and see that the maximum rated speed of the helicopter is about 150 miles an hour, I think 152 miles an hour. Now, these days, trains, when they leave the Channel Tunnel or are on their way to the Channel Tunnel on the English side of the tunnel, go up to 186 miles an hour. So this helicopter would not keep up. So you might think, well, that's a problem, isn't it? Well, no, because as we've just said, The trains in 1996 were not using the Channel Tunnel rail link. In fact, the Channel Tunnel rail link was still a glint in quite a lot of civil engineers' eyes. It hadn't been built. And so the train used to weave slowly along on these old lines, and it would reach 100 miles an hour occasionally. I think most of the time it's going quite a lot lower than 75 miles an hour, so the helicopter could easily keep up. So this one is another hit. It's fine. We'll perhaps get to why it's the filmmakers then undermine that momentarily, but for now, we're giving them that. So, what next? Here it is. Right. Okay, this is an issue. So, having just said that the train doesn't need to have its overheads, doesn't need to have its pantograph up, the power collector there, because there are no overheads. You can see down here there's one rail, there's a second rail, there's a third rail and a fourth rail for the two tracks, but there should be a third rail here or here for current collection. So you've got the running lines kind of running underneath the train, and you should have what we call the third rail, or the DCCR, should be placed there, and you should then have a shoe that collects current from that and powers the train if it's the 90s and it's going towards the Channel Tunnel. It's missing, so I'm afraid that would be... it's a miss. Ah, now, another thing that's worth noting, you see all this nice blur, the train is kind of whizzing along. It's going faster than 100 miles an hour. It's quite clearly going about 200 miles an hour in this scene. So even though we've just said the helicopter would be able to keep up with this train if it was doing what it would have been doing in the 90s, in reality, the way they filmed this train, and as you will find out in a minute, the train they've chosen goes quite a bit faster. And so this presented a problem not only for our reality. So, you know, I'm just going to say this, that they're going to get they're getting a buzz for that one. Sorry. But also, actually, when they were filming the helicopter, so they actually had the helicopter here kind of going along, and there's our helicopter. And when they were filmed, you know, they had the train here kind of underneath. When they were filming back, they didn't have a train. Obviously, the train was later added. When they were kind of filming, particularly when they were filming shots back of the helicopter couldn't keep up with the speed that they were trying to emulate when they were doing the plate filming. So they realized that they needed to get rid of the real helicopter, and actually the helicopter that we see throughout is actually CGI. Very good CGI. It's a very cleverly put together sequence, this. Anyway, right, let's keep watching. Ah, yeah. Curves. Let's talk about curves in a minute. Oh, there's Tom Cruise looking very worried. You just saw the train was going around a curve, a really sharp curve. And indeed, you can see that the train up here is sort of snaking around the curves. This is a very curvy bit of railway, in fact, that's whizzing along, much curvier than the railway that it should be travelling on. We'll get to that. But there's a thing worth pointing out here, which is when a train goes around a curve, particularly when it's going around a curve at this speed, and okay, this speed is clearly ridiculous. It just doesn't look right. It's going way too fast for that curvature. But if it's going around a curve fast, trains tilt over, actually. The track underneath them tilts over, and that tilts the train, and trains tilt over like that in order to counteract the forces from the centrifugal forces as they go through the curve. So we kind of tilt them over to kind of counteract some of those forces for passenger comfort. So if you like, you've got the kind of the two rails here like this, and they're kind of maybe on a nice sleeper. On straight track, fine. The two tracks are kind of straight. On a curve like this, you see here, you might have this is a nice cross section. You have the two rails like this, and we actually tilt them over. So if you've got a curve kind of going through here, we'll tilt the rails over. That's called super elevation or cant. There is no super elevation here, and you can see by the fact the train is completely flat where Tom is holding onto that pantograph. There is absolutely no rotation of the vehicle, so everyone would be getting thrown around inside that train at the speed it's going. I mean, more likely the thing would come off the rails, but certainly no one would be sitting enjoying their champagne and trying to upload a knock list. But so I'm afraid that is a miss. Nope. I mean, the stunts are brilliant in this, but let's not kind of put it to one side. The stunts are absolutely brilliant. Here it is. Let's fast forward a little bit, shall we? I mean, this is unmistakably, it's worth just saying, this is absolutely unmistakably not the southeast of England. It's quite nice, quite rugged, southwestern Scotland. And the reason for that is because, well, it was the only kind of two-track mainline that they could get access to do the plate filming. So that helicopter, this helicopter here, it's a CGI helicopter. But they were kind of filming the plates, you know, they were sat on a train kind of filming those plates going either direction. And this is not what the southeast of England looks like, because this is being filmed. This is being filmed here, up here on the thing. There we are on the on what is known as the Glasgow, and it's the Glasgow and Southwestern Main Line, Glasgow Southwestern Line, and it should actually be getting filmed down here. There we are in this bit here, down here on the, and at this time it would have been on the Southeastern Main Line. There we are. So you can see quite a distance across the whole of the UK. Like, what is that? Many hundred miles apart. So it does look quite different. But it's, you know, you only gonna be annoyed by that if you know it. Actually, I do think it's still quite a nice. If you kind of put that to one side and just look at the continuity of the shots, the actual continuity is they pass along the that particular railway line is nice. Although I dare say trains will never reach these speeds on the GSWL. But anyway, right. So I'm afraid that is another miss. Let's keep watching. Such good stunts. Ah! Now, this is the first shot we've got showing the train that is the kind of the hero, if you like, of this whole sequence. And you can see pretty clearly, there we go, that there is TGV. It's an SNCF TGV. In fact, the SNCF logo is here. They've had many logos of SNCF. That's the French railway operator. It's a TGV. This is, in fact, probably a... I'm not a train nerd as much as I'm a railway nerd, but this to me looks like it is a TGV Atlantique, which is the second sort of production line of TGVs, French high-speed trains. Let's just have a look at the train that it should be. It should be this yellow thing here, this lovely yellow Eurostar Class 373. It's kind of the train should be white and yellow and a bit smaller, as I'll talk about in a second. The other thing you'll notice, actually, we'll come back to this, is the much smaller cab window. If you kind of look there at the small cab window, you see there's a big cab window on the... You see there's a big old cab window here. And then if we go back to this one, you can see there's quite a small cab window. We'll come back to that. I'm afraid that is very much another miss. Let's keep watching. It's a good helicopter, isn't it? We can see here that there's a nice bridge here. Lovely bridge. And given what I've just said about this being a continental gauge TGV, it's worth very briefly talking about the difference in sizes in trains in terms of their gauge, their loading gauge. This isn't track gauge. This isn't the distance between the tracks, the rails. This is the space above the tracks to fit trains in. In the UK, in Great Britain rather, GB, we have what's called W6A. It's this kind of gauge here. It's roughly about the size of most passenger trains fit within that. Freight trains can go a bit bigger in certain places. You compare that to the continental gauge, and you'll see that the trains are wider. Quite a lot wider. There we are, wider, and also they're quite a bit taller as well. You can see there's that bit of extra height there between the two. The issue with this is that this train is probably going to smash through all the bridges that we've seen it passing through. So you can, it sort of doesn't look quite right. They've sort of shrunk it. So in fact, if I get rid of my scribbles, you can see to sort of fit it in, it looks a bit. It doesn't look quite right. They kind of look like they've shrunk it to fit it in. It's a miniaturized train to sort of fit in there. The real TGV looks bigger when it's sat on the rails than this one does, so a little bit strange. Also, this helicopter, I mean, it's a bit mean to pause it, cause it looks a bit like a model, but actually it's brilliantly animated. They did a fantastic job on that. So I'm afraid that is yet another miss. Loading gauge. What else can we pick up? Let's continue. Ah, yes. It's a very nice reveal of the tunnel. It's a fun shot where he looks up and sees the tunnel approaching. You can see the TGV, incorrectly chosen TGV, stretching out into the distance. The trouble is, the actual portal of the tunnel, there are a few things going on. Firstly, actually, let's get a picture up. There are a lot of hills. The downs here, so the kind of these hills here that you can see block the view of the sea. So you can't see the sea in front of the not from the height of this helicopter, which is kind of barely above the train. The other thing you see is there's loads of stuff. There's all this gubbins here, all this stuff going on, of which we can't see any. Particularly though, so that's one. I'm going to give it one buzz for the fact that you can't see the sea. There are a load of hills in the way, so they're going to get a buzz. The second thing they're going to say is. The train, by this point, should have switched from it would have picked up its shoe collecting electricity from the third rail, and it will be relying on on the overheads. So I would not be dropping and hanging and dangling cables from the bottom of a helicopter, you know, if that happened to be a thing that I might decide I needed to do for narrative purposes. I wouldn't be doing that here. So I'm afraid this is the point where the lack of OLE is a problem for kind of reality. So they're going to get another strike from me. But let's keep watching. Here it is. Yeah, see, I wouldn't be dangling this because that would be wrapping around OLE and electrifying that helicopter. It's a fun sequence though, right? Also, they don't seem to cover much ground very quickly given that they're going at 200 miles an hour. Right. And these things, I think we spot some other useful handles later on in this sequence, but I'll pick this one out and then I'll not double jeopardy them. It's very strange on an aerodynamic train to leave a big gap with a big metal hook on it. So it's very convenient. It looks very convincing here in this image with this nice close up. But this hook thing, why would you? What's that for? You don't lift trains up from their roof. You generally they're kind of jacking points on the underside of the vehicle. This wouldn't exist. It'd be nice and smooth because it's an aerodynamic train. And little gubbinses like this, you know, if you consider how many things are much effort goes into keeping it streamlined, little gubbinses like this aren't good for streamlining for a train going at 300 kilometers an hour. In fact, these are designed for 320, so no, I'm afraid that's getting a big old buzz from me. But let's keep watching. Jean Renault is not happy. I wouldn't be either. Okay, so before I pick on it, they did quite a nice job. I mean, okay, again, it's mean to pause CGI from the 90s, because it starts looking a bit, you start losing your ability to suspend disbelief. Lifts, but actually they've done quite a nice job of designing what looks like a kind of a fast looking tunnel portal. They've not done a bad job, but you know, there's gubbins, there's kind of a van here that they've CGI'd on, they've made the hedge disappear here. You know, they've not done too bad a job actually. This kind of stepping up is pretty contrived, but it looks fairly smart and tidy. The Channel Tunnel was a new thing at this point still, people were kind of excited by it still, you know, they've been running services for a few years. The problem's this emptiness here is just a field, but I'm afraid the reality is quite different. I get rid of my scribbles. Here's the portal up here. This I've just done a nice big thick circle at. If our train is going this way, there's our big arrow, the direction our train's going in. There's all this stuff here, all of this. That is the loading bay for cars and lorries to get onto the shuttle, which the really big oversized vehicles that take kind of trains that take vehicles through the tunnel. You've got all the parking, you've got all this stuff here, and then you've also got the motorway running through. This is not, you know, the train also should have just gone through Ashford, which is quite a big built-up area with flyovers and all sorts, because there's the split to Ashford station as well, Ashford International. So they've omitted all this stuff, which again simplifies animation and minimizes complexity, but it's a bit of a glaring omission for anyone who's taken that train. And the reason why things like this, okay, some of the things I'm nerding out about aren't particularly important, but some things it's a little bit like, if you're watching the film, it's nice to feel familiar with things that you've done and then are happening in the film. And if it's something that's totally fictionalized and contrived, you kind of lose your immersion a little bit in the film, which is always a bit of a shame. That's a buzz, I'm afraid. And it's not the only buzz tunnel-related that's going to be. There's that portal. Jean Renault. Right, yeah, so he's not looking happy at all. Again, they've done a good job of... This is not a bad looking portal. You know, you look at this, it's got all the kind of, it's got this nice kind of bits of complexity. There's no OLE, you know, no overhead line equipment. That's clearly an issue. They've got some buildings that are clearly for something. There's some level of, in fact, this looks almost like it. I mean, they might have entirely CGI'd it. It looks potentially like a miniature. They've kind of done quite a nice job of it. There is an issue though. Get rid of my scribbles again. And that is that fundamentally the Channel Tunnel is not a single bore tunnel. And if we ignore the shape of that tunnel for now, we're just going to assume that that's just a nice portal shape, that's given it that funny elliptical shape. But the major problem is that the Channel Tunnel is in fact not one bore. It is two single track bores, because that makes aerodynamics a lot easier. It makes them a lot safer. It means you can close one while keeping one open for things like maintenance. Lots of reasons why you do that. It means less material, less excavated material if you want to kind of keep the trains going faster, so you want to minimize the kind of the aerodynamic interruptions as they pass each other. It keeps the diameters down, keeps the tunneling a bit safer as well. So lots of reasons why you tunnel. And in fact, you can see there's a nice little snip from a TV series. You can see there's the two bores. And actually, so you got bore number one, you've got bore number two, and then in the middle here is actually there's a maintenance tunnel, a kind of a smaller diameter maintenance tunnel. So each of these two tunnels is, 7.6 meter diameter, and then in the middle there's a smaller kind of a 4 meter diameter tunnel about that size, which is a service tunnel. And little vehicles can drive up and down in that, but it's decidedly, two portals here. One, number one, number two. It's not just the single ellipse that we'll see here, so I'm afraid that's a buzz. But let's crack on. Oh, still a great action sequence. I absolutely love it. It's so good. Let's go back to our instruction manual for the MD-520, because we've just seen a helicopter go into a tunnel. How feasible is this? Well, some numbers. So the if we get rid of that, so from that we can see that the if you've got the helicopter, this distance here, this diameter, so this is the distance from here to here, is 8.4 meters. Now, in order to get through the tunnel, so if you imagine you've got our tunnel here, we need that distance. Let's call this distance, let's call it D for diameter. We need this D here, D of the blades, and then if we call this distance sort of here. This distance is going to be, it's the diameter, and we're going to call it the tunnel. So we're going to call it DT, and we need DB to be smaller than DT, right? Okay, that's pretty basic. You need the blades to be smaller than the tunnel they're going into. Now, people might go, oh, those blades never fit into the channel tunnel, which is correct. I already said that the diameter of the actual channel tunnel, the actual bores are 7.6 meters in diameter, which is clearly greater than 8.4 meters. But we're not going to do double jeopardy. The film's canon has established that the diameter of that tunnel, it's a two-track tunnel, which means that you're looking at a diameter of at least 9 meters, maybe even as much as 10 meters, which does just accommodate 8.4 meters. So actually, this is not getting a fail. This gets a pass. They get a pass on this one. This also very much gets a hit. Because it is incredibly realistic, because even though there's Wi-Fi in the new trains, the Wi-Fi still doesn't work very well. So yeah, very much when you go into the tunnel, you lose signal. It's true. And you stop being able to upload your knock list. It's a disaster. So they're annoyed. But how annoyed is Tom Cruise, who, if you remember, just got booted off the train? So the speed they're now going through that tunnel is quite a lot more realistic. So actually, they've slowed down. From that shot there, within the inside of the cab here, with the poor train manager having a bad day, they've actually slowed the train right down, which is realistic, because the trains are limited, even with the two bits of high-speed line either side. The trains going through the channel tunnel are limited to 160 kilometers an hour, 100 miles an hour. So yes, it would look a bit slower, which then again makes it realistic for the helicopter to be able to keep up, although it's in a tunnel, which is doolally, obviously. Now, the other thing was that the, let's skip back and watch this.
No, don't, it'll crash into us. Accelerate.
So the train manager there is saying accelerate to a driver, which they know they should never do. Your train manager would never give an instruction like that. But, clearly our man here is having a bit of a bad day. What's interesting, though, I think, and this is a little tidbit, is that the channel tunnel is actually designed for trains to safely travel through at up to 200 kilometers an hour, so 40 kilometers an hour quicker than they currently go through now. That's 125 miles an hour rather than 100 miles an hour, certainly from an alignment perspective. So it's not beyond the realms of possibility that the train could accelerate a bit through the channel in the sort of crazy situation where a helicopter is flying along behind it. So you know what? I'm gonna give them a hit for that. Let's keep watching. it's good fun, isn't it? But this train is going at between 100 and 125 miles an hour. That's not fast enough to keep Tom Cruise, little though he may be, from being, it's not enough air to keep him completely horizontal like this, or kind of for him not to just fall sideways. So much as it looks fun, it's a bit far-fetched for me. The physics don't add up. Is it one of those widgets that I was talking about that just magically appear on the train? There are things to say about this. Firstly, the horns don't sound like, the TGV horns don't sound like that. The oncoming train would not see our boy Tom, but I do think a train approaching, coming along and seeing kind of two lights and a weird red shape, because if we accept that they're going, if they've got a 200 mile an hour closing speed, we've accepted they're in the same same double track tunnel. We've accepted that, so they are used to seeing the driver's used to seeing a certain pattern of lights with the train oncoming. And I'd probably be honking the horn if I saw something else weird going on, because if you might think it's a track worker, at which point you'd be hammering on the horn to get the track workers clear anyway. So okay, fair enough. It's not for Tom. It might be for the helicopter. So I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt. Although I think the honking probably goes on for a bit longer than it might, because trains going at 200 miles an hour towards each other, there's not very long between the trains seeing each other and the trains being past each other. But anyway, so I'm still going to give them that. I noticed that Jean Reno is shaking around a bit, but I don't know how the two trains fitted underneath. A helicopter and a train fitting in within one tunnel seems far-fetched. Bearing in mind the widest part of the helicopter is the top of the helicopter. Okay, so let's move back to tunnel shape. So you can kind of see it. The reason I've paused it here is you kind of see this elliptical tunnel shape. And if you remember the portal, the tunnel shape was kind of like this. It's like this sort of weird elliptical sort of shape. You just would not build a tunnel like that. So if you can imagine all the force going through here, this arch, not just kind of downwards here, but also sort of the upwards force from kind of the whatever it is, you know, the water pressure or the rock, that's, you're squishing, it's a very flat arch, which means that this would have to be really, really strong, and it would have to be thicker and stronger. You couldn't have a kind of a uniform diameter. You'd end up with kind of thicker bits and thinner bits. It would be a right mess to lay, and it means you'd have to have all sorts of bespoke, just be a nightmare. You do not build new bored tunnels like this. You always build them as a nice kind of round, simple circle, apart from my bad sketching. And that way you kind of have a nice, even sort of loading throughout, which is much easier from an engineering perspective. And then what you can do from that point is that then you can lay a bit in there, you can fill that in, lovely. Then you've got your nice space for your train there, and you've got some space for maybe a walkway here sort of thing. You can people there, and whatever it happens to be, you've probably then got space for kind of the overheads as well. The train can sit under that. All that good stuff. This elliptical shape, much as it looks like it would fit the two trains in it, it's just not realistic. Even if you had a two-track tunnel like that, you'd still have the circuit, you'd still have a really big sort of, if you ignore my dreadful sketch, you'd still have it as a circuit, and you'd end up with the kind of the flat bit there like that, and you'd have to fill in loads of it like that, and blah, blah, blah. Hence why you don't go for double-track tunnels. There's a lot of wasted, a lot of wasted material up here that you've excavated, and then you have to just turn into cement and put back in the tunnel again. So hence why we go for the single bore, but also the elliptical shape is just structurally not a very good idea, so I'm afraid that gets a tremendous buzz from me. So before Jean Reno gets carried away trying to slice Tom Cruise's head off, one of the things you notice through here, and again, it's partly a necessary cinematography choice, which is to have the tunnel being very well lit. Lots of lights flashing past, and it gives you the sense of speed. There's a dynamism to the imagery. It gives a bit of variety when you've got this kind of whatever this big blue thing, door thing is going past, kind of a bit brighter. It just gives a sense of motion, a sense of progression, which is necessary from a filmmaking perspective. From an engineering perspective, firstly, what are those lights for? There's no need for all those lights. You don't need to see your way through the tunnel. You have lights, you install lights or potentially have temporary maintenance lights that you can switch on, but you wouldn't have them running all the time. It's a waste of electricity. It also means you've got bulbs running all the time that would go pop, whereas it's better to just leave those bulbs off most of the time. You don't have to change them as frequently. The other thing is, through this long tunnel, you remember we had that the little tiny little cab window of the Eurostar train? Well, that in combination with having kind of quite dim lighting within the tunnel. If you take the channel tunnel, you sit in the Eurostar, look out the window, you see it's very dark. Well, part of the reason for that, and not having kind of this mesmerizing kind of series of lights flashing past, is to avoid discombobulating drivers. There is a belief that the length of this tunnel and having a big window rather than a kind of a much smaller window would really kind of distract and discombobulate drivers. When they emerge, it'd be kind of, oh, a bit, oh. Essentially, you have the combination of smaller cab windows and less lighting. It kind of helps to avoid sort of spacing out the drivers a bit as they pass through what is, you know, the longest railway tunnel that passes under the sea. It's a very long railway tunnel. You know, it's a good old length. It's 50 kilometers or something. It's a good little tunnel. So the drivers, you want to make them feel nice and comfortable. So I'm afraid the lighting gets a buzz. Let's keep watching though. It's the Mission Impossible music. Here we go. It's all good stuff. He's reaching into his pocket. What could he be reaching into his pocket for? Having been mean about the lighting, I think it's worth saying that ILM and the production team, sort of the design, the production design, is fantastic in this tunnel. It looks brilliant. It's really convincing. You've got these bits of kind of, you've got tunneling. Okay, in fact, there's a nice picture here of the model. So they used primarily CGI environment, but they also recreated it as a model for some of the specific sequences, as you might imagine, some of those sequences, as we're about to see, that require some physical effects. And they did a really good job, right the way down to like the track fastenings. You know, you've got these sort of all the sort of gubbins up here. You've got sort of random. Okay, they've replaced the OLE. They haven't put overhead line equipment in, but they've kind of just put random stuff hanging from there. But everything right down to the fastenings, the slab track down here. As a track engineer, obviously I pay a lot of attention to that part of the railway. It's brilliant. They've done a really good job of it. I think they've done a fantastic job. In fact, here's me. Let's get rid of the scribbles. Here's me next to a slice of the Real Channel Tunnel that's in the National Rail Museum in York. I'm looking very pleased with myself, and you can see it's got these sorts of bits and pieces here. There's got like cable racks. There's a little walkway. You can see the slab track down here. It's not quite so clear in the photo. And another walkway on the other side. Gives you an idea of the size, by the way, because even in this tunnel, the Eurostar trains are quite a lot smaller than the Les Shuttle. The big ones that carry lorries in them are huge. They're the largest kind of gauge trains in Europe, I think. Massive. But anyway, that gives you an idea. So it's a compliment, really. I'm going to give them a hit for that because they did a really good job of recreating quite a convincing looking tunnel. It's fantastic. Here he is.
Red light! Green light!
Let's stop here for a moment. Not only because Tom Cruise is flying through the air in a brilliant stunt. This is a brilliant scene. Don't take my kind of engineering canoodling as being a criticism. It's a brilliant scene. In fact, they've nicely lit the tunnel. It's got lovely piping up here and all sorts of gubbins floating around. Now, the reason I paused it here is not to talk about the fantastic cinematography or the great stunts or the really good effects work. It's not to talk about the fact that the pacing of the action sequence is fantastic. The fact there's very little dialogue, which is great. You know, it's just all in moves. It's all in the dance, the maneuver, the kind of the action, the choreography, really, of the sequence. No, it's because I've seen comments before. I saw comments I think it might have been on one of the YouTube things I was looking at when I was watching people, or there's comments under an article about this, and someone talked about the fact that if you had an explosion within the tunnel, that it would potentially collapse and the sea would pour in. Now, this is, or even if that didn't happen, that it would somehow warp the tracks and cause, you know, and cause untold damage and derail the train. No. It's a tiny little helicopter that weighs at most a few tons, you know, or maybe a few tons. In fact, that's something I could, you know, look up in my rather shonky looking manual. You know, it's a few tons of helicopter, all lightweight materials because it's an aircraft. Those aren't going to cause the train any bother. They're not going to cause, let alone the concrete, those units weigh, you know, tons, multiple tons, 5 tons, I think, each of those sort of pre-cast concrete segments that the tunnels built up. If you want to learn more about how tunnels are built, then there's a fantastic Rail Matter episode that I'd recommend you go and watch on my channel about one of the HS2 tunnels being built. These huge segments they get put in. In fact, there was a fire the year the film happened. There's a massive fire inside Le Shuttle, inside, you know, a lorry caught fire, loads of shifty stuff in it. Huge fire within the tunnel, and it actually did. It was the fire was intense enough and raged hard enough that it actually brought the, it actually, concrete spalled off the linings, and they had to rebuild that section of tunnel because the linings were so badly damaged, and yet the tunnel did not collapse in, no water came through. Firstly, it's within a section of, you know, it's within a section of chalk that's underneath an impermeable layer. There's no seawater coming down through. Secondly, even the water that's actually within that chalk marl, it wasn't coming through even after the fire. So no, that's not going to be a problem. And you can see the tracks in this picture, actually, quite nicely. You can see the tracks here are basically fine as well. So no, explosions don't cause problems to rail infrastructure like this, really. Explosions don't commit a lot of force, even though the explosion would be a lot of compressed air and force within the tunnel. It probably wasn't very pleasant for everyone. His ears might have popped in the train after the explosion, but no, damage, it kind of catastrophic damage from an explosion within a tunnel, not so much. So so you know what? They're getting a ping from me for that one. Yeah. Dun, dun. Yeah. I mean, okay, there are a few things going on here. We just heard the train is braking and decelerating. So, okay, there are some things to unpick here, right? The last, the fiddliest thing that's going on here is, well, why is the train braking? Well, the best thing to have done in this situation would absolutely have been to keep moving. The driver wouldn't have been seeing any of this, so the driver would have, like, you know, would have been keeping hammering forwards. Add to this the slight confusion that we've established in the canon of the film that the train is not powered by overhead electrification because there isn't any. So so actually, there's no interruption to what's powering the train, whatever it happens to be. I guess in the Mission Impossible world here, it's the gas turbine version of the TGV succeeded because this train is a gas turbine version somehow without any electricity going into it. But anyway, although it can't be because there's also a pantograph. The canon of the film is clearly confusing from an engineering perspective. Fine. But given that there's a member of train staff keeping an eye on things in the rear, we've seen him looking rather displeased, they might well have requested an emergency stop. You know, they might well have hit the emergency stop button or requested the driver to emergency stop, so that could have happened. However, though, fine that it's feasible that the train is braking, but the problem is that from that explosion to this point now where it's braking almost to a stop, it's about 10 seconds or something. It's not at many seconds. A train traveling 100 miles an hour is going to take more like 90 seconds at extremely hard braking, you know, emergency brake application. Still about going to take about 90 seconds to get, I mean, it's possibly like a kilometer and a half, like maybe 1100 meters, you know, 2/3 of a mile to actually get from 100 miles an hour down to zero. So I'm going to give it both a hit and a miss simultaneously here. There we are. Hitting a miss simultaneously. I mean, it's a fantastic, it gets, in terms of an action sequence, it gets a big, like, double tick from me, which is, you know, it's a fantastic, fun, very entertaining, and incredibly well shot, convincing, both from a, you know, a CGI perspective, from a choreography perspective. Stunts are brilliant. Tom Cruise been very happy with himself. All the stunts are fantastic. Everything hits and is uncomfortable. You feel the bruises as he's being thrown around. It's brilliant, very convincing. But there are some engineering issues with it. But I think, in fact, let us, in fact, watch the end. Oh, there we are. Oh, it's a nice ending to the sequence as well. Brings it all back down to being peaceful. And there's our poor train manager, who's just not having a very good day. It would be a stressful day in the office, I'll freely admit. So, Mission Impossible 1996. What are we thinking? If I'm going to do more of these, I'm going to give them a hit and miss score. And, you know, we added up the numbers. So, if we give it a hit and miss score, we have 9 hits and we have 17 misses. So, what's that going to do to the score here? We have some bonus points, which I'm going to give out of 5 because I think it's not just about engineering. Obviously, there's, you know, I'm going to keep it in terms of realism. You get a general vibe of realism. Actually, the sequence looks and feels quite real. Like, the things I've picked on are kind of some kind of geographical or specific engineering features, but actually, generally, it feels like quite a real sequence. You don't have to suspend much disbelief to kind of get absorbed and carried away in it. So I'm going to give it 4 out of 5 potential bonus points, giving a final score of -4, which, you know, it's if we look at our leaderboard, which currently is just this because it's the first in the series, if we list off a rank, the film, and what its score is, well, Mission Impossible is currently rank number 1 with a score of -4. But what other films are we going to watch? Well, in order to get a rank 2, I'm looking to you folks. What are we going to look at next? If you want to send me the film telly scenes you want to hear me critique, or see and hear me critique, then you can do so on Twitter. You can find me at Gareth Dennis on Twitter. You can go to the Discord server for Rail Matter, which is at garethdennis.co.uk/discord. And if you're a Patreon person, you support me doing more of these. So patreon.com/GarethDennis for more of this. That has been An Engineer Watches. I have been Gareth Dennis, and I'm going to bid you a merry evening. Cheerio, everyone. Cheerio.